have Hadia, I'm still Lamia here. We have Lucy, Yudana here. They've been up and down on this issue of sexual violence. At a point, there was a time a case was reported to us. So I called her, she said, when she was about when one of the chief executives in the state called her and said, don't announce it to the public. Don't let the public know this is happening in the IDP camps. So can you imagine if we are hiding what is happening in the IDP camps, our problems will be solved? We had that experience some few years ago, whereby we were stopped from announcing cases of sexual harassment on IDP camps.
Just a few thoughts as a lawyer. I'm a lawyer back in the United States, and I've represented many survivors of sexual violence. And listening to Dr. Mukwege talk about silence reminds me that one thing that the survivors I've represented needed was for me to know how to talk to them. Because all of the services we have, all of our good intentions, are based on somebody saying what they need, as Dr. Mukwege said, which is an act of disclosure, which is very difficult to make, but also from a service provider standpoint, very difficult to elicit in a safe and ethical way. And so I think one thing that survivors do need, and they've told me this, is they need us to train ourselves in how to make space for them, how to establish the right rapport, how to take time. I think the problem with thinking about legal accountability is the legal process and timeline doesn't match the timeline of recovery and disclosure that many survivors have. Everyone discloses in a different way. So I think one of the survivors' needs is for us as service providers to really learn how to sensitize ourselves. And that includes medical care providers, it includes legal professionals, it includes social workers, members of the state, judges, everybody. If we don't know how to create a supportive environment for disclosure of sexual and gender-based violence, we can never provide the help that people need.
What do you think we need to fulfill this path itself? And looking at it again from your work across the world now, I hope you come and do the holistic approach in Nigeria. That is the hubs already on the table. Are there converging trends? Is there something that is also similar that we can find amongst all these perpetrators?
What I talked around many countries, sexual violence used in conflict is really used as a weapon. It's a weapon that is very effective because it's not destroying only the body, but it's destroying also the mind and destroying the community as a whole. And I can say that what is happening, for example, in Congo, it's clear that rapists are doing it in the world to destroy the families, communities, and the country as a whole. Because rape a woman in front of, for example, the mother of his family, in front of, rape a woman in front of the husband and children, is that the way to show that we have power on you and we can do everything on you. But if it also destroys all the link between the families, it destroys the fabric of the society. And this is happening in Congo. But if you go, for example, in Central Africa, you can see that the way that rapists are doing is different. But the objective is the same, to destroy women, to destroy the community through destroying women. Sometimes women are asked to just ask to apologize. But even to apologize, we are not able to do it. So for me, accountability and reparation, justice and reparation should be a thing that everyone. It's not only for repression, but justice is very important because it can just to help. Get the repetition. And for some people, the repetition is done by the same. Just because they don't print. The second thing is, if you want to preserve the social